Good morning, church. Good morning, church. We are getting ready to worship the Lord. So wherever you are right now, whether you're in the building with us or whether you're at home in your room or your living room, I'm going to invite you to stand up to your feet and just kind of set your heart, set your eyes, set your mind on the Lord. Because we are about to sing a song called Reckless Love. It's not new. But some people have an issue with calling God's love reckless, and I totally get that. If you're one of those people, you need to know I'm not in disagreement with you here. Our God isn't reckless, our God isn't careless, our God isn't chaotic or confusing. But when I think about the places where the Lord chased me down or the times where I didn't deserve his love, have to do that, you know what I'm saying? He didn't have to bankrupt heaven and put himself in the form of a man and come and suffer and die for us just so we would hopefully maybe one day choose to have a relationship with him. He didn't have to do that. So in some ways, in some respects, maybe we call it crazy love. Maybe we call it unending love or unconditional love, but he didn't have to do it at all. But he still chose to. He chose to go through pain. He chose to go through what he did on the cross. So that we would hopefully maybe be sitting in this room or sitting in your living room where you are right now and look towards him and just say, like, I choose you, you know? So his love definitely chases us wherever we are and wherever you are. And if you don't want to call it reckless, that's fine with me, but it's insane. It's insane love. And I don't know where I'd be without it.
Yeah. don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. In all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. In There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen the loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, your presence, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, it's all we need, it's why we there's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, well, I've tasted and seen. sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the at his voice. How great is our God.
Hey, we just want to say welcome. We're so glad that you are with us today. We love you. And I just want to say, whether you're in this room today or you're at home, you're a part of us, you're part of our church. And we know that today that there are local folks that are at home or somewhere else watching or listening to us. But we also acknowledge that there are folks all over that are watching or listening to us today, and you may not be geographically close to us to where you can actually physically be here with us, but we know that you're here with us online, and we just want to say welcome. We love you. We feel like you are just as much of a part of us as someone sitting right here in this room, and we love you. We pray for you. And I want to invite you, if you're online, if you're listening, whatever the media platform is, I want to encourage you to be a part of us also by reaching out. If there's anything that we can do for you, if we can pray for you, we have prayer requests online. We have our church app that you can download. But also, you can always email us or call us or instant message us, whatever suits you. We would love to hear from you, and we would love to just know how we can serve you and be a part of your lives as we feel like you're an important part of ours. Would you open your Bibles with me to John chapter 10? And I want to talk about a thing that is, I wouldn't say controversial, but I would say is often is misunderstood by many people inside and outside of the church. But I want to talk about hearing from God today. Now, for those of you that have grown up in the church, if you've been doing this for any length of time, this is probably not a surprise for you. But coming from the outside, I know just in my own life, I remember years and years ago hearing somebody say that God told them to do something, and my immediate response was, really? God talks to you? You hear voices? And you know, it could be easy to mock or easy to question, but you know, here's the reality, is that if God doesn't still actually talk to people today, then we would be doing a disservice ever saying that it's possible to have a personal relationship with him. In fact, it would be fruitless. What relationship can we possibly have where the parties in the relationship don't communicate and don't talk? And a marriage where there's no communication is not a healthy marriage. A friendship, mother, father to their kids, if there isn't communication, there's no real relationship at all, and especially because God's word tells us time and time again, it demonstrates God's desire to speak with us. And how could we ever honestly say that we follow Jesus if we don't actually hear his voice? John chapter 10, verse 27, Jesus says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." See, following is absolutely critical. You know, being a Christian isn't about just going to church. It isn't just saying, I am a Christian because I believe in God. In fact, the scripture says that even the Satan and his demons believe that God is, and they tremble in fear at his name. So it's not enough to believe. We actually need to follow. Well, how could we ever follow someone or something? I don't want to call God a thing, but how could we ever follow anything unless we have instruction and direction, unless we can hear how to follow? And Jesus makes no qualms in saying that his sheep know his voice. And in fact, in John chapter 10, it says that the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but he comes to give life and life more abundantly. And in that same passage, part of this abundant life, part of this life with him, he identifies the ownership or the relationship with his sheep, and that the sheep don't get led astray by the thief's voice. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but the sheep don't listen to a stranger's voice. They don't listen to the thief's voice. They listen to his voice because he knows them and they know him. So how does God speak to you and I? There's a lot of examples in scripture, and I want to go over a few of these, but can I just say, first and foremost, he's God, and God speaks any way he wants to. And if we could just settle in our hearts and just settle in our thinking, if we could settle in our spirit, if you will, that he's God, and God can use anything he wants. In fact, there's an example in scripture where God speaks to a man through his donkey. And if God can use a donkey to speak in scripture, then God can use anything today to speak to you and I. Well, John 4, verse 24 gives us an example. This is Jesus speaking, and he says, "God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." Now, see, there's a key element right here that Jesus is giving. He says that those who worship God, in other words, those who are in relationship with God, will do so in spirit and in truth. There's two elements. First is truth, and I love scripture. I love the word of God. It is absolutely critical for us to understand that we have been given in writing, in black and white and red for some, that we have been given the word of God. We've been given his more than just good ideas. We've been given his principles, his truth, his spoken word inspired through people for us. We have the truth, and we can and should live our lives by that, as the measure of our lives. But Jesus also says that in spirit, not just in truth. And the thing behind that is that God is spirit. God is not a man. God is not flesh. And while he created men and he created flesh, he created natural things, God is a spiritual being. And he created you and I to be spiritual beings. Now, not to do too much of a history lesson, but back in the book of Genesis, when sin enters the picture, sin comes and breaks the relationship between God and man. And the part of the relationship that it broke was the spirit-to-spirit communication between God and man. It was at that point that man could no longer just come as he is and communicate with God. But that line of communication was broken. And after it was broken, now man was left without that spiritual connection, where man is now trying to approach God through his flesh, through his mind, through his thinking, through his intellect. Well, you cannot approach God, you cannot connect or relate to God in merely natural means, because God is spirit. So first and foremost, to communicate with God, to have him communicate with us and to communicate with him back, we need to understand this element that God requires us to worship him in spirit and in truth. Without the spirit, the written word is just words on a page. Without the spirit of God, we just have some principles, but it's the spirit of God that turns them on, that gives us the, scripture uses the word rhema, which is the inspiration. It's the life behind it. In fact, the word speaks of itself, that the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. It's living and it's active. It's the spirit of God with the word of God that becomes living and active in our lives. And that is how God communicates and how God interacts with us. See, communication with him is spirit to spirit. It's not brain to brain or mouth to ear, the way that we communicate in the physical. The Lord speaks to our spirits, not usually in audible words, although there are examples. Although we do see in scripture, and I have heard testimonies of people hearing either an audible voice or a near audible voice where they couldn't tell the difference. But God also speaks to us in thoughts and impressions. And I want to go through a list of ways that God speaks to us. One of the first examples, and probably my favorite, is from 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter 19. There's a man named Elijah, and Elijah has just had an incredible encounter with God. In fact, he's been in opposition with the prophets of Baal, of a false god, and these idol worshipers are opposing God and opposing the people of God. And basically, there's a showdown, and the prophet of God comes and says, well, let's see whose God is real. And so he builds an altar, and he has the prophets of Baal build an altar. And prophets of Baal try to call down fire from heaven to ignite the altar, and nothing happens. They try. Nothing transpires. And then Elijah, the man of God, calls down fire from heaven, and fire consumes his sacrifice and consumes the altar of Baal as well. And there's this incredible event, and the nation sees this, and he says, choose, make a decision to the nation. It's time to decide who you're going to serve. And all the prophets of Baal were eliminated, and there was a big conflict. Well, the queen of the day was in support of the prophets of Baal, and she was mad at the prophet, and so she threatens to kill him, to have him killed, just like she's had other people killed who were proclaiming the name of God, who were serving God. And he flees, and he runs off, and he finds himself at a mouth of a cave. And the scripture says that there is an earthquake, and there's fire, and there's wind, and there's these demonstrations. But it says each time, but God was not in the earthquake or the wind or in the fire. And then Elijah in the cave hears a whisper. He hears the still small voice of God. And God then begins to speak to him. And And what a great story or a great example. Sometimes in the natural, we're looking for natural means for God to speak. And I believe in signs and wonders, and I believe that God does use earthquake and wind and fire and is not a band. But God does use all of these means to communicate with us in the natural. But because God is spirit, God speaks to us through our spirit as well. And I believe that the most common way that God speaks to us is through the still small voice, through these whispers. And you might be surprised to hear this, but yes, God's voice oftentimes could be confused or come to us through our own thoughts. And you know, the word says that his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. Well, God does communicate because he communicates to our inner being. God can communicate through our thoughts. He can give us impressions. He can give us ideas. And I'm going to detail some of these. But the way that I believe that is so intimate and so personal and for the believer, because we have the Holy Spirit residing in us, our communication with God isn't an outward thing. Our communication with God is an inward thing. Because he placed his spirit inside of us, God doesn't have to use a megaphone. He doesn't have to use someone on the outside, which he does that as well. He doesn't have to use skywriting or some other external means. But God can speak directly to us in our most intimate, personal way. And that is speak right directly to our heart. And you know, another way to say that is in our thought life. The second way God speaks is through answers. And James says, if anyone is lacking wisdom, he should ask and not doubt when he receives it. And see, it takes faith to listen to what we hear, to ask and not to believe and to not doubt. But so many times, if we're looking for an outward sign, we're looking for an outward confirmation, but so many times God just simply speaks to us through giving us an answer to a problem or an answer to a question or he gives us an answer to something that we otherwise wouldn't be able to figure out on our own, but God just reveals it. Sometimes we talk about an open door or a closed door. It's an opportunity that suddenly comes open. We prayed and we asked God, and then next thing you know, this opportunity comes up. And it can be in the form of a natural answer, or it can also be in the form of an internal answer where we're just considering, contemplating, we don't know what to do, and then all of a sudden we get this, we get this answer on the inside. The next way that God speaks to us is through our desires. Psalms 37:4 says, delight yourself in the Lord and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Now, I heard it said one time that this means that God will give you whatever you desire. And that's not what this scripture is saying. Basically, it's saying that if you delight yourself in him, if you put your focus, you put your fulfillment, you put your hope and trust in him, then he will place desires in you. One of the ways that we know what God wants for us, what he wants us to do, sometimes where he wants us to go, ways that he would have us live, is by placing a desire in our lives. And sometimes we can mistake those desires for our own desires. It's like, wow, I just have this desire to just go do nice things for people. Where do you think that desire came from? Or I just have this desire to go be with little kids and just take care of them and love on them and tell them about Jesus. Well, for some of us, that would definitely be an obvious God desire, because I love my kids. I'm not sure if I could hang out with a whole bunch of other ones. But God puts this supernatural desire inside of us. Or maybe the desire is to do something that seems really practical, but there is an application that's going to help people or bless people, or maybe there's a spiritual application of that thing. And one of my favorite ways to discover how God is leading and guiding us is to discover desires that he's put in our lives, where there's things, there's passions, or there's things that just light our fire, and someone says, well, I just don't know what God wants me to do. And then my next question is, What God-given desires, what passions has he placed inside of you, and why do you think they're there? And you might be surprised that God has put desires in you that you just thought were you. You just thought you had an interest in helping out at a food bank, or you might have thought it was just an interest of again being with young people, or helping out at a senior center, or writing. Your desire, your passion was writing, and maybe God put that desire and that passion inside of you because He's given you something to write that's going to advance His kingdom, or that's going to bless people, or it's going to have an impact on the planet. Sometimes God speaks to us by removing or changing desires. I'll never forget the season when God moved us out of student ministry into life group ministry in our church. And I still love the kids. I still do. I still have the heart of a youth pastor. But there was clearly a shift in Heidi and I in a season where we went from just being consumed, all we could think about was being with the kids, to now suddenly all we could think about was this draw to build groups, to build relationships in our church with not just adults, but with all ages. And you know, we also find in Scripture where Jesus was moved with compassion. In fact, the times that Jesus did incredible miracles, Scripture says that He was moved with compassion for the people, and then they were healed, and then He ministered to them, and then they were delivered. And oftentimes God can speak or move us through a compassion, a supernatural compassion for someone or something, where maybe you hear all sorts of needs come across, and they're just, yes, they're needs and they're important. Then all of a sudden, this one need or this one situation or this one person is presented to you, and your heart breaks for them. Well, that can be a real tangible way for God to speak to you, for God to demonstrate what He would have you do by breaking your heart for somebody. And the next way is through wisdom. Again, James chapter 1 says, if anyone lacks wisdom, let them ask God, who gives liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to them. James 3:17 says, wisdom from above is first pure, peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. See, there is a wisdom that comes with age. I hope there is a wisdom that comes with experience. But there is a supernatural kind of wisdom that Scripture contrasts earthly, worldly wisdom that is selfish, that is concerned with world values and world principles or self values. It's narcissistic. But there is a wisdom that comes from heaven. And this is the description. It's pure, it's peaceable, it's gentle, it's willing to yield, it's full of mercy, it's good, full of good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And see, one of the things that we have learned to really look for and lean into, and there's times where we find ourselves, we go, wait, did we ask God for wisdom on this thing? Because God has proven Himself time and time again that when we just need some good, solid wisdom on what to do with our lives, how to respond to a situation, how to talk to somebody, how to respond to maybe something that either happened in our business, in our lives, in the church, in a relationship, it's something that's happening in the world, God gives us this promise that if we ask, if we need it, and we ask, that we'll give it, and we need to trust that He's given this wisdom. And we shouldn't discount God just supernaturally giving us wisdom for something. Oftentimes we think that we need a clear sentence, you know, God, what should I do? And we're looking for skywriting, or maybe we're looking for a word for word, you should go do this and then do that. Meanwhile, God is placing a supernatural wisdom in us that just seems like it came from nowhere. Like all of a sudden, I just have this sound idea, or I have this sound knowledge or understanding of how to do this thing. And along with that, wisdom is knowledge. It's knowing what we don't know for ourselves. See, God oftentimes will speak through us through putting, we can call it a word of knowledge. It's like telling us something about a situation or somebody or something that we wouldn't otherwise know on our own, that God just reveals it to us. Sometimes it can be revealed in a supernatural gift. In fact, we've seen this recently here in a church service where someone said, hey, there's someone in this room that has this medical condition. And sure enough, there was someone there with that medical condition, and God wanted the church to pray for them. But there's also times where God will give you and I in the workplace or in our homes or wherever we may be, where God will just reveal something to us, give us understanding for something, or give us knowledge of something that we don't know for ourselves. And that's his way of communicating to us, but especially his way of helping us out. And finally, the last way is through discernment. And discernment, the Webster's definition of discernment is the act or process of exhibiting keen insight and good judgment. Now, there is a natural discernment that comes hopefully with age and with wisdom. Some of us demonstrate more discernment than others. There's been times in my life where I've been just such a knucklehead where I didn't really demonstrate a whole lot of discernment or insight or understanding or good judgment. But with the Holy Spirit living in the life of the believer, God can give a supernatural discernment. He can reveal the unseen, the behind-the-scenes details, or give us caution or confirmation regarding a situation, a decision, or even people. Have you ever come into a situation or into a room, and all of a sudden just something inside of you just says, oh, it's not good. This is not a place for you to be. Or maybe you're having a conversation with someone, and they say, trust me, I'll enter into this business deal. And something inside of you is saying, don't do it. Well, I believe one of the ways that God, the Holy Spirit, blesses us in communicating and leading us and guiding us is through Holy Spirit-driven discernment. But I also believe, unfortunately, church, that so many times we ignore this. We call it our gut, and I don't know how many times I've said or heard other Christians say, well, you know, my gut feeling was, but I ignored it. Well, oftentimes that gut feeling was the Holy Spirit giving you discernment to run away or to go toward that something. Or maybe just giving you discernment of caution towards somebody because maybe they have something going on in their lives or maybe there's just something about them that God just wants you to be cautious about. Maybe it's not even a big risk, but it's just like, hey, don't go into business with that person. Or just guard your heart with that person because there may not be something there or in a situation. Or, you know, there was a time where I knew God was going to be moving me from one job to another, and I had somebody call me up, and they offered me this great position with great money, and I was like, okay, all right, God, this is awesome. This must be an answer. But as soon as I started talking to the person and getting more details, and everything sounded so good, but something inside of me was just discerning, don't go this way. And I, fortunately, by the grace of God, I listened to that discernment. And would you know that within a week, that company was bought out, and everybody with the positions that I was going for was laid off. And you know, that was what a coincidence. No, that wasn't a coincidence. That was the Holy Spirit working through discernment in me. And you know, I believe as a pastor, one of the greatest teachings or things that I can do to impart into your life is this discernment to discern through the Holy Spirit, to discern situations and circumstances. Yes, even discern teaching, even discern when someone gets up and preaches something or says something, or maybe you see or hear something in church. You know, we should not just take everything at face value. In fact, the scripture says that we're to test the Spirit. Well, how do we test the Spirit? We test the Spirit through Holy Spirit-given discernment. And there is also a spiritual gift, which I believe is a whole nother level, the spiritual gift of discernment. It's the special ability that God gives to some to know with assurance whether certain behavior or teaching is from God, from Satan, from human error, or human power. It is divine enablement to distinguish between truth and error, to discern the spirits, differentiating between good and evil, right and wrong. Well, this sounds a lot like what I quoted about scripture earlier, is that the word of God is profitable, is good for reproof, is good for correction, but it also says that it's living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, able to divide between soul and spirit. So we have the discernment of the Holy Spirit that helps us decide if something is truth or error, and we have the Word of God that working in tandem that helps us divide between truth and error and soul and spirit. Well, there's some other ways that God speaks to us. He can speak through dreams. Joel chapter 2:28 is a great reference. He can speak through visions, prophetic utterances, either to us or through us or to and through someone else. One of the prophetic gifts is tongues and interpretation, which we believe God does speak that way. God can speak through words of knowledge, through other prophetic gifts. God can speak through signs and wonders. We see the example in the New Testament of God confirming his word through signs and wonders through Jesus' disciples and through Jesus himself. And God can confirm the word today through signs and wonders. And in fact, we've seen people receive healing for, you know, they have a sickness or an ailment and God just miraculously touches their body and heals them. And that isn't just for a show, just to draw a crowd, but it's for God to confirm his word and his truth about who he is so someone's faith will be built up or so someone will put their trust in him. And then, of course, finally, God can speak through an audible voice if he wants to. Again, how does God speak? However he wants to. And our job is to learn how to hear. How do we train ourselves to hear? And I want to wrap up with these quick keys on how to hear God. Psalm 46 says, "Be still and know that I'm God." The first way that we train ourselves is to be still. You know, there is so much noise pollution these days. There's so much distraction. And, you know, whether you blame it on the enemy or you blame it on whatever else, there is so much media, there is so much news, so much information. We live in an age where you can get any information right at your fingertips, but all of that information is not necessarily a good thing. And having so many voices, and we have access using our thumbs, texting, we have access on our phone, on our email, on all these devices. It is so easy to communicate these days. One of the biggest detriments for you and I is this noise pollution that prevents us from just settling down and paying attention and listening to see what God wants to say to us. So be still. The second one is to be in the Word. Chapter 1, verse 2 says, "Meditate on his word day and night." Psalm 119:1, "I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you." See, Jesus said true worshipers will worship in spirit and in truth. And one without the other is out of balance and will get you off track. And the word is so important, but there are people who have the written word, but they don't have the spirit. And therefore they don't have the true revelation. They don't have they can't get it. It's like reading somebody else's mail. I just don't get the Bible. Well, it's because you don't have the spirit translating it for you. It might be written in your language, but there needs to be a spiritual translator because God speaks spirit to spirit. But we need to be in the Word of God. Without the Word, the Spirit can just get... Can I just say that without the truth of the Word of God, just a spiritual life, there's all sorts of spirituality, there's all sorts of kooky, spiritual, New Agey, a lot of beliefs out there. There is no shortage these days of supernatural things, but the supernatural, the spiritual, without the truth is not God. In fact, it's a false God. It can be a false spirit, and if it is not the Holy Spirit, then it's an opposing spirit. If I could just say that. And next, we need to be observant. Isaiah 55:3, "Incline your ear to me, hear, and your soul shall live." So we need to look and listen for the Lord. And next, we need to be filled. Ephesians 5:18 says, "Do not be drunk with wine, which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your hearts to the Lord." Don't be drunk with wine, which is disposition, going back to verse 18, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. And next is to be diligent. Hebrews 11:6, "But without faith, it is impossible to believe God. For he who comes to God must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him." We need to come to God. We need to pursue him. We need to believe that he is. But we also need to expect that he rewards those who press in. He rewards those who diligently go after him. And you know, if I could just give you a word, don't give up. You know, we love things microwave fast. We love them right now. But if there's something that I know about God, is that God oftentimes doesn't work on our timeline. And so many times we want to hear from God, we want a word, we want him to speak to us, but then we want God to hurry up and talk to us now. God, come on, give me a text message. God, send me an email. I just need it right now. But you know, the scripture says that they that wait on the Lord will renew their strength. We already quoted the verse, be still and know that I'm God. See, part of our diligence is not giving up and knowing that God is going to work on your behalf. God is going to speak. But sometimes we just need to diligently seek and not give up, not grow weary in doing good, as the scripture says, or not grow weary in pursuing him. Sometimes God uses silence to draw us closer. Sometimes God uses silence to let us know that we just need to go back and trust the last thing he told us. We're looking for a new word, but we need to sometimes take that silence is that, okay, if he's not speaking now, or if I'm not hearing clearly now, what was the last thing he told me to do? What did his word present to me in this situation? And finally, number six, we need to be present. Hebrews 10, verse 25, and let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near. We need to be present where the word of God is being spoken. We need to be present with other believers who are also learning how, who are also cultivating their relationship with him and learning how, training their ears to hear God. One of the greatest ways that I can confirm in my life that I'm hearing God is to be around someone else that is also pursuing God and hearing God. And I can't tell you how many times on a Sunday morning I'll preach a message and afterwards someone will come up and say, Pastor, I just can't believe that you just preached what has been on my heart all day. Or Pastor, I was praying and I was asking God to reveal something to me, and then you preached that message and it just brought confirmation. Well, that's because God speaks through each of us, and oftentimes God will bring he'll bring confirmation through brothers and sisters. One of the reasons I'm such a proponent of life groups or small groups and being in smaller groups, I love Sunday morning, it's a great celebration, but sometimes the best way for us to train our hearts to hear God is by being in a small group, with being in other people that we're in relationship, that we trust, so that as we're hearing something, we present something, we say, hey guys, I think God is speaking this to me. What do you think? And letting other people in the room also hear from God and speak to that and bring confirmation. And boy, there is nothing like having something on your heart from God and having a brother and sister in Christ that you know and trust come up and say, hey, God is speaking this for me. And it just brings this confirmation. And now I can either make this decision or go through this thing or whatever the situation might be, I can go through this now because now not only has he spoken to me, but he's confirmed that I can hear his voice. And man, the comfort and confidence that I get in those times where he just confirms that I can hear his voice gives me such a security. And listen, I want you to have that same security. Whether you're here in this room or you're watching online or listening on iTunes or whatever the media platform is, listen, I'm praying for you that you would hear God's voice. I'm praying for you that you would learn how to train your heart to hear him. I also want to invite you, don't do it alone. We have life groups. If you're too far for a life group, you can join us online. Like I said earlier, you can download our app. There's different ways to connect, but don't do life alone. Scripture says iron sharpens iron. And oftentimes God presents us with preaching. He presents us with online things or live in person. Our job, like point number six, is to be present. So I want to invite you to be present. And whatever means or mechanism God has given you to be connected, be present and be connected. But if you're watching today and Jesus has not been in the driver's seat of your life, and you're saying, you know, you're talking about hearing God, and I'm just not even sure if I'm right with God. You know, Scripture makes it pretty plain and simple. You know, the message of the gospel, what's the gospel mean? It means good news. The message of good news is that salvation, freedom, hope is available for every single one of us, and Jesus made it easy. In fact, the Scripture says, if you believe in your heart that he is who the Bible says he is, if you believe that he went to the cross, he died for your sin, that he rose again, excuse me, and you confess with your mouth that he is Lord, which means you say with your mouth, Jesus, be in charge of my life, says that you will be saved. It's that simple. And you can just simply pray that prayer, or even you can pray it in your own words, or you can just simply pray it like this. Jesus, I believe. I believe that you've done these things for me. I believe that you've paid the price so that I don't have to. I believe that you're the hope that I'm looking for. And Lord, Jesus, I need you to be the Lord. I need you to be in the driver's seat of my life. That's it. It's that easy. Well, let me pray for you. God, I just thank you for our friends and family that are with us today. Lord, I pray, Lord, as you have already met them through worship, as you've already been speaking to them through the word, Lord, I just pray that you would confirm to them, Lord, that you would make clear to them, but especially, God, that you would develop in every single one of us a heart to hear and to be led by you. Because Jesus, you said that your sheep know you and that you know them and that they follow you because they hear your voice. And so, Lord, help us to be followers of you by hearing your voice. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, God bless you, and we'll see you next time.
A great way to stay connected with what's going on here at Mountain Life is to use our MLC app, which is available on the store as well as the Google Play Store. Also, Mountain Life Church is hosting a women's conference October 15th and 16th, which is a Saturday and a Friday. For more information and to register, visit mymlc.org or feel free to use the MyMLC app. We are very passionate about missions, and if this is a missions trip that you would like to join with us, please feel free to contact us and let us know. We are also very passionate about next steps. Every first and third Sunday, we meet together and we talk about your next steps and how you can get involved in our family here. So please feel free to join us every first and third Sunday. Also, if you guys have any prayer requests that you would like some agreement in prayer with, please feel free to reach out to our prayer team. We would love to pray alongside with you. Authentic, loving relationships are at the core of what we do and who we are here at Mountain Life. We love to worship God and celebrate together on Sundays, but life and real life relationships happen in life groups. We're launching new and existing life groups the week of September 19th, so don't miss out.